By definition, a storyteller conveys events in words, images, and sounds, often by improvisation or embellishment. The Living Bread Radio Network presents The Storytellers with Tony Agnese. Today, you'll hear a faith-based, inspirational story that's both heartfelt and heartwarming. And now, let's meet today's storyteller with Tony Agnese.
Hi, this is Tony Agnese, and welcome to this edition of The Storytellers. We're heard every Tuesday at 2 p.m. with a repeat on Sundays at 9 a.m. both Eastern Time on the Living Bread Radio Network. The program is available as a podcast immediately following the show, beginning at 2:30 p.m. Eastern Time at thestorytellersradio.com. It's available on iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn Radio, and wherever else you might get your podcasts. And later in the week, it's available at the Catholic podcast site, Breadbox Media. The program is sponsored in part by CatholicBook.net. All of the books featured on the program are available at CatholicBook.net. Now, each week on the show, we feature a guest and discuss their personal journey of faith and the ministries they share as authors or speakers, bloggers, and radio and television hosts, and today is no exception. My guest is Kendra Von Esh. Kendra is a Catholic speaker and TV news anchor for Shalom World, which is a Catholic television network that was initially based in India, still is, and has studios in Texas and in Chicago. And Kendra, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks, Tony, for having me.
It's great to have you on. We talk about everybody's personal journey. You wrote a book called Am I Catholic? A Struggle with Faith, Humility, and Surrendering to God. And that book is available both in paperback and hardcover, ebook and audio. And you'll know that she narrated it herself, and you'll know that when you hear her great voice. You had one of those metanoia kind of experiences that we talk about, haven't you?
Yes, most definitely.
Tell us a little bit about that experience and what led you up to a question of, am I Catholic?
In italicized, bolded, and underlined. Because I didn't even know what Catholicism was, to be really honest with you. I was, and I'm holding up some air quotes over here, confirmed Catholic, mm-hmm. which means my parents kind of put me through the sacramental process. And on the other end, I'm confirmed Catholic. And when I say put me through, I mean, you know, loading us in the back seat of the car in our soccer uniforms. We're doing our homework in the back seat. I'm memorizing prayers in the back seat. And I come out on the other end, confirmed Catholic, and have no clue what it means.
You know, that seems to, it seems to me that that's an awful lot of Catholics that are in that same boat. And, you know, they go through the sacraments of initiation. And, you know, a few weeks ago, Kendra, interesting thing, I spoke at a prison on Tuesday night, and I spoke to a confirmation class on Saturday, and I began the talk at the confirmation class by saying, you know, the people at the jail didn't want to be there, neither do you want to be here. You know, it's just you know, the parents kind of putting them through it. So you go through and you're confirmed, and in most instances that lasts until about you know, the latter part of high school, first part of college, and then next thing you know, your daily your weekly mass is at you know, St. Mattress of the Springs, and you decide to sleep through Sunday morning. Is that what happened with you?
Yes. I mean, we in my family had no, we never talked about religion. We were the Creasters. We were those Christmas Easter goers every year. And that's about it. So when I ended up moving out on my own, I wasn't practicing any kind of religion, certainly not the Catholic faith, because that boring mass and all those rules that I didn't believe in. So quite frankly, the culture raised me. I was not getting up and going to mass because of all those reasons and then some, and I didn't need God. I really didn't. Why do I need God? I've got this great job, this great career. So I'm good. I've got this life. I don't need anything else.
Mm-hmm. And then every now and then when we feel like we've got it, we realize we don't. Is that what happened to you?
Yeah. So even though I thought I had it, I listened to what the society said would make me happy. You know, a lot of money, power, prestige, you know, go suck up every pleasure that you possibly can. Life is short, party hard. I lived that way. But I was really, if I look back, never really happy. I mean, why am I constantly wanting to change my state of being all the time by drinking and drugs? And how come I'm constantly comparing myself to other people, never measuring up? I'm never good enough, smart enough, educated enough, and always feel inadequate. So what had happened for me was I didn't have this moment so much, but my dad went in for a quadruple bypass surgery out of the blue. And that was when I started praying like crazy, like 18 hours straight on my knees in tears. Not for me, but for him, because he's a pretty active 70-year-old. He's on ice skates, you know, coaching hockey, and this comes out of nowhere. He's not overweight. And I just, the whole family was freaking out, to be honest. And I think I might have just kicked that door open a little bit for God by praying that deep from the heart at that time when that happened.
You know, sometimes we reserve prayer for, you know, and a lot of young people, I say this because of my own experience, we reserve prayer only for those times when we absolutely, positively have nowhere else to go. And, you know, you have control of your life, but you don't have control of the fact that your dad's having this surgery, and that sends you to your knees. You know, the Barna study came out last November said 51% of people under the age of 30, when asked their religious affiliations, say none. And many of those people, you know, are confirmed Catholics or you know, grew up with some faith experience. And a lot of parents bemoan the fact that their kids have fallen away. But many come back. But what I'm seeing recently is some information that says that the younger generation's not coming back. And you wonder where they get the strength when something tragic happens. What do they call upon when it's beyond their own control? Is that part of that crack that opened in the door for you?
So what happened for me, and you would think that because my dad came through with flying colors from the surgery and recovered great, that I would have, like, gone back to church and thanked God.
Sure, absolutely.
But no, I was one of those nine lepers, right? I just walked away and, you know, never came back and thanked God. So mm-hmm. I just went on about my life. And as a matter of fact, I was thinking again about society and how, you know, we should be looking and feeling. So I was watching Dr. Oz. We love that program. My husband hates that program, by the way, mm-hmm. because I always bring stuff home that I see on it. And I was looking at a diet cleanse book, and that was where I thought, okay, wait a minute. My husband and I are carrying on an extra 20 pounds, you know, so maybe we might have a problem with our health. So let's go ahead and do this cleanse. And while I'm looking through the diet book, there's this pie chart in the diet book, and God speaks to you in amazing ways. And so here are all these little segments of my life, and one of them said spirituality. And that's when I said, whoa, like I've got nothing going on in this piece of the pie. Mm-hmm. So I thought, just like the young people today, all right, I'll go back to church, but I'm not going back to that Catholic church. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go to that big box church down the street because there's police officers directing traffic, and it looks like it's fun. I mean, there's a lot of people going.
Mm-hmm. So and they've got the big screens out in front with the words to the songs and a rock and roll band playing. And
exactly. Wow. Fun, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'll have that happy feeling when I leave. And it just so happened that the night before Easter in 2013, which is when I stepped foot back in the Catholic Church, my family was asking me, well, where my non-practicing family, by the way, I must reiterate the fact that nobody's going to Mass, nobody's practicing the faith, and they're giving me flack about going to a non-Catholic church. You know, they're like, but you're Catholic, but you're Catholic. And I'm like, okay, all right, fine, I'll go to the Catholic church. So that's what happened. I stepped foot, scared to death, all by myself, because I wasn't getting my husband to go, who's also not practicing and currently isn't practicing either. So it was a scary day on Easter 2013, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, most Catholics in that element there are kind of cultural Catholics. Catholic because grandma was or mom was or whatever. And when you ask what they are, well, I'm Catholic. Well, do you go to Mass? Well, not necessarily, but you know, you don't think of yourself as anything but Catholic culturally, but certainly not by participating. So Easter 2013, you step back into a Catholic church for the first time. I'm assuming all sorts of bells and whistles went off, and there was a eureka moment, and you threw up your hands and said, "This is it."
I wish. Let me tell you this. This is the most embarrassing moment probably of my life, because I'm walking in thinking, all these people sitting here are so much holier than me. They know what they're doing. I do not. So I pick the back pew. Thank goodness there was a seat. And, you know, as the priest says, "Peace be with you," I'm screaming, "And also with you." That is how, right? Like, how embarrassing is that? That's how long it's been since I've been to Mass.
You know, it's kind of funny. I went to a wedding. This probably happened to you. I went to a wedding, and when the priest said, "The Lord be with you," about half of the people in the church said, and also with you. So what it said to me was about half the people in church hadn't been there in a while. You know, you talk about seeing ears, Christmas and Easter. There's a lot of Catholics that only go to Mass, before ahead of the bride or behind a casket. That's about the only two times you see them. I call them hatch'em, match'em, and dispatch'em Catholics. They're there for the baptism, the wedding, and the funeral. So you are embarrassed, and then the alarms went off, and you had a eureka moment and threw up your hands, right?
Kind of. So I sit down. Usually, you know, when my parents and I went as a family, my dad would be like with the Eucharist in his mouth, walking out, getting the car pulled up so we could beat the traffic, and we're all running out before the Mass is over. And so here I am, still sitting there, and they say, "Oh, have a seat for the announcements." I didn't even know there were announcements. So I'm waiting, and they say, you know, "Hey, for Divine Mercy Sunday," again, no clue what that is, they mention that there's going to be confession at 2:00. And all of a sudden, everything stopped for a moment, and I thought about my mortality. And I said, "Man, if I believe a half of a half of a half of a mustard seed of this Catholic thing, then I'm pretty sure that I am going to hell, because I know that I had mortal sins on my soul. And to be honest, even a few mortal sins that I didn't know were mortal sins at the time."
Mm-hmm.
So that's what happened. I ended up stepping foot into confession after 26 years the following Sunday on Divine Mercy Sunday. So yes, I was a direct recipient of that beautiful, merciful day. And I had an absolute supernatural out-of-body experience as the priest was absolving me from my sin.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the aha kind of moment for me, mm-hmm. my pivotal turn, if you will.
So how do you get from there to being, a Catholic author, and to be a successful speaker and so forth, kind of jettisoning the job that you had? I mean, that seems like a pretty big step to a guy like me, that go from where you were to where you are now. Did that take place quickly, or is that something you discerned over time?
No, I mean, in the beginning of my journey, so if you think about it, it'll be 6 years this Easter.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning of my journey, I was so freaked out about my out-of-body experience and the supernatural joy and this waterfall of love. I call it like this liquid love. I could barely move. It was something that I've never experienced in my life. And I've taken a lot of drugs in my life, and I will tell you that I could have taken them all and never felt like that ecstasy moment that I was feeling there. So when I got out in my car after confession, I sat there and I cried. Of course, I was bawling in the confessional as well. And I kept thinking, what is this Catholic thing? Because I've asked God for forgiveness many times on my own, and I have never felt that. So what happened to me was the Holy Spirit just put this unquenchable thirst of, what is this Catholic thing? So I was just researching online and stumbling across Eucharistic miracles and realizing what the sacraments are and what sacramental graces are. And so I was learning and learning, but I was still struggling with changing my life, because you really have to believe in the full teachings. And I'm not this cafeteria Catholic, so I had to look myself in the mirror and say, okay, you've done your research. You've come to find that this Catholic faith is the truth. Now what are you going to do? Mm-hmm. And that was probably 2 years into my journey.
Wow.
Wow. So, you know, I stumbled and fell and stumbled and fell into a lot of temptations and former habits and behaviors. But for the most part, I really learned how to pray and how to ask God for the grace to change my life. And sometimes he was pretty fast, and other times he said, you know what, you're just asking me from your head
and
not from your heart. You know, like I'm this St. Augustine,
yep.
you know, Lord save me, but not quite yet type
yep.
of thing. So
yep.
it was a process for sure.
The old everybody wants to go to heaven, but not everybody wants to go now. You know, you want to have a little more time. Kendra Von Esh is my guest. She is a Catholic speaker and a TV news anchor and author of the book, Am I Catholic? A Struggle with Faith, Humility, and Surrendering to God. When we return, we're going to take you from the Eureka moment right up until today with Kendra Von Esh right after this on The Storytellers.
CatholicBook.net is your source for all things Catholic. With a large selection of unique items, we are here to serve the Lord by serving you. Visit our local shop in Canton at St. Raphael Books and Gifts, 4365 Fulton Drive Northwest. We are your source for all things Catholic. CatholicBook.net, for 30 years, a commitment to service.
Welcome back to The Storytellers. This is Tony Agnese. Kendra Von Esh is my guest. We've been talking about her career as a Catholic speaker and Shalom World news anchor and writer, and how she got from where she was to where she is now. I guess that's where we left off. And what was your former job, Kendra?
So again, listen to what the society said, and I just went for the highest paying job that I hated.
mm-hmm.
I am not an IT girl. I'm not a technical person, but I ended up going down that path because it pays very well, especially if you're a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a chief information officer for a global company for the past, I don't know, a couple decades. So that's what I did. And
mm-hmm.
it was great. I mean, it paid the bills, that's for sure.
And then you jettison that all of a sudden. So your husband's got to think you're nuts. How did you get to that point?
Oh, my gosh. So I cried all the way along because I was actually in between jobs, and I had to decide, am I going back to the, you know, corporate world, or am I going to do what I feel God is asking me to do and share the amazing sacramental graces and how incredible this Catholic faith is that I ran away from my whole life. You know, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? So I hired a life coach, and I went through this whole process, and finally I had to ask my husband. And I seriously, like you said, I thought he was going to commit me to an insane asylum. You know, like, what do you mean you're going to walk away from all this money? We have a lifestyle to live here, honey.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? Oh my gosh, Tony, he gave me his yes, and he said the most godlike thing. We'll take it day by day. And then, of course, I start bawling my eyes out and freak out and think, oh, my gosh, now I have to do this. You know, like, I've never, you know, designed a book, wrote a book. And I already had the book written, by the way. But I haven't done speaking before. Yes, I'm technical, but I can't design a website myself. So I had all these things that I had to do that I've never done before. And that was where I really had to rely on God. You know how you said earlier how the young people, where do they go?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, at least I knew this because I kept saying, God, okay, if you want me to do this, you've got to help me because I'm pretty clueless. So the amazing thing was he opened all these doors every time I had a problem or a struggle. I just walked through them.
Mm-hmm.
And it's been fabulous having the courage and the love of God all the way because I'm not doing this for him. I'm doing this with him. And that's pretty key. Keep rooted in prayer.
You're making this journey, however, alone. That, you know, and I have a friend who's done that as well. Your husband still has yet not, you know, kind of come along. And so all of these things that are happening to you, all of these experiences, all of these Holy Spirit moments, if you will, how do you do those? And do you share them with your husband? And what is his reaction when you do? And is he softening? Where's he at this point?
You know, it is exactly that. I don't make him feel guilty. Every now and then, I'm inviting him to Mass. Just this week, I invited him to someone for Easter this year is offering the Mass for me. So I'm so honored. That's like the best gift ever, to be alive and have a Mass offered for you. So I asked him if he would come with me. I'm bringing the gift down with him. And I'm praying that he'll go to confession so that he can actually receive the Eucharist with me that day, because he's not going, so we all know. And for those of you who are listening that don't, the not going to Mass is a mortal sin. So he asks every now and then, how was Mass? What did you learn today? And then I share with him those Holy Spirit moments that have happened where I've literally heard and felt God, guide me and lead me and answer the questions that I need answered. For example, going down this path, leaving my executive career. Another one was, he asked me, we were looking to put our dog down and we couldn't determine what time, when, right? Like, should it be around Thanksgiving? Should it be before Christmas? Should we wait? And he looks at me and he goes, well, why don't you take it to God? See what God says. You know, so I hear these things out of his mouth and I'm like, oh my goodness, I know Mary's got him. He's going to come. It's just not on my time.
Amen.
Right? I mean, I just keep praying. I am so persistent and so confident that it will happen. I just don't know when. So I'm super excited to see how that pans out. So it's just sharing. Oh, and have you ever gone to a healing service or a healing
Sure.
mass?
Sure. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
So I rested in the spirit for the first time ever. And it freaked me out. Mm-hmm. Nobody told me what was going to happen, by mm-hmm. the way. Mm-hmm. So I'm on the ground saying, oh my gosh, I can't move. And you should have seen me when I got home. I was thinking, he's going to think I'm crazy, but I have to share this with him. And, you know, he kind of looked at me and I was like, honey, I don't know what to tell you other than what happened. And even last night we were listening to a story on YouTube of a person that had, like an open wound on her forehead. And when she came out of confession, she was confessing an adulterous affair that she had. The open wound was closed and it was gone. It disappeared. And he's like, that can't happen. You know, how could, it's an open wound. And I'm like, but see, honey, this is the whole thing about miracles. You have faith means you can't necessarily see it, touch it, prove it. It just happens, right? Mm-hmm. I said, that's mm-hmm. like, that's what miracles are, bringing people back to life and giving the blind their sight. And so he's logical. He's not there from the faith perspective yet.
Some people and many, many very logical thinkers think that faith resides somewhere beneath logic, when the opposite is true. Faith, when logic won't explain it and it goes beyond that, above that lies faith. That's where our faith is. And you mentioned that you're having a Mass, that Mass is being said for you at Easter. Here in the area, the Port Claire sisters, once a year they have a Mass for me, and I've had an opportunity to go a couple of times, and I have to pinch myself, because generally when they say the Mass is for, I go, am I still here? Hopefully I am. Tell me about your spiritual life. What is what are you doing currently? And you know, obviously, we evolve in our spirituality. Our spirituality strengthens. We add things. You know, what are some of the things that you do on a daily, weekly basis that have really helped strengthen your spiritual your spirituality and your Catholic faith?
So I was looking for, it's hard to find a spiritual director. Let me start with that. And I was trying to figure out, how do I find one? And one day I was in confession, sharing about the fact that I want to have a pure heart. I don't want my ministry to be about me and have me get in my own head. I want to glorify God. I want this to be about Him. And so the priest on the other side of the screen says, well, can I help you? And I said, sure. And he says, I'm a Ignatius spiritual director. So I end up talking with him, and he has been my guide and has really helped me understand, like, the most critical part of our relationship and our spiritual journey is our identity as a child of God, and also the relationship that we build with Him, which isn't waking up every morning and doing the checklist of prayers, which I do. I read the scripture, I meditate on the scripture, I read the saint of the day, you know, I've got the morning offerings and the universalis that I go through, my rosary is recited, the chaplet, oh, let's throw in the one-year St. Bridget prayer and the 12-year St. Bridget prayer. I mean, what am I doing to myself? Mm. Where is the silence? Where is that, you know, conversation and just resting in God? So that was part of my transformation over the last couple of years, is making sure that I hear the Holy Spirit and spend that time with God in silence. So this Lent, that was one of my commitments, was to, and I haven't done it so well, but it was to try and go to adoration. It wasn't to try. It was to go to adoration once a day and be with him for an hour.
And listen.
And that just, and listen, yeah. No. And not read. Not pray the rosary, not do anything else, but just gaze at him and listen and feel, you know, and try to take things to him that I'm struggling with, or just wait and hear what he says. But I haven't been all that great. I've not drank wine, whatever the word is there, but that was my other part of my Lenten sacrifice. So I've kept that all the way through, but I haven't done an hour a day, and I'm just trying to squeeze in 15 solid minutes every day in silence.
You bet. Kendra Von Esh is my guest. We've got less than a couple of minutes. Tell me, you went on, this has gone so quickly. Tell me a little bit about speaking. Your speaking took off, and now you're out there speaking about faith.
Yeah, it's been so wonderful. Again, all these doors have opened, and the past year has been a wild, fast ride. I can't believe 2018 is over. And I've bridged out and started putting some programs together, because people would ask me after I would speak, how did you increase and mature your spiritual life and your prayer life? And so I created a 40-day prayer program. That's a video program. So it's me in your inbox in a video. 15 minutes a day, it's not that big of a deal, but it helps, you know, shake up your existing prayer life and starts with focusing on that relationship. Mm-hmm. And then this whole Shalom thing came in, you know, a guy saw me speaking and said, you need to be on TV. And so then I'll be doing the regular news program for them, which is every week, and then some specific spot shows and such. And I'm actually probably going to be looking at a radio show sometime down the line. We'll see. That hasn't come to fruition, so I don't want to say too much about that and jump the gun. But
it's
been awesome. Awesome.
Kendra, thank you so much for being with us. This has been a joy to have you with us, and I thank you so much for spending some time with us today. Kendra Von Esh has been our guest. She is a Catholic speaker and author of the book, Am I Catholic? A Struggle with Faith, Humility, and Surrendering to God. Kendra, God bless you. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you. You too, Tony.
And that's our show for today. My thanks to Kendra. And if you missed part of the program, it re-airs this coming Sunday at 9 a.m. And it is available right now at thestorytellersradio.com or on all of your favorite podcast sites, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn Radio. This is Tony Agnese. Thank you for joining us. God bless you. We'll see you again next week for another edition of The Storytellers.
We hope you've enjoyed today's edition of The Storytellers with Tony Agnese, a production of the Living Bread Radio Network in Canton, Ohio. To learn more about today's storyteller, go to thestorytellersradio.com. There you can subscribe to the podcast and hear all of our past shows. And join us again next week at this same time for The Storytellers with Tony Agnese.